Bailey. For those of you that don't know me, I'm the Assistant Director of Scowcroft Institute, and it's my privilege today on behalf of Professor Natsios, the Director of Scowcroft Institute, and the Dean of the Bush School, Dean Crocker, to introduce the first in our International Affairs Seminar speakers for the academic year 2014-2015. For those of you in second years, and those of you that have come to a lot of our Scowcroft events, as you know, we always start off the year with our Army Fellows. We are extremely lucky here at the Bush School to have three of the Army War College Fellows. Only 39 universities could get fellows to come, and we've got not just one, we've got three. And that's pretty exceptional on our part, and we're one of the places that they keep telling, don't worry, when money gets short, we're not taking them away from you. It's very competitive for the guys to get here. They have to actually ask to come. There's a longer list, and it's based on their backgrounds and other things that get them here. The three fellows we've got today, and I'm getting old, so I'm going to use paper today to talk to you real quick. First one is Colonel Blake Alexander. He is one of our own. He graduated from Texas A&M in 1972 with a degree in political science and German. 1992. Because I'm not, and we're anyway. So, yeah. He'd been one of my upperclassmen. He's also got a master's degree in leadership and management. He's an aviation officer. He's done just about everything you can in the leadership world, to include commanding a battalion in the aviation world. More importantly, he's been just about everywhere the Army's been in the last couple of decades. He participated in humanitarian relief operations for Hurricanes Katrina and Rita. He's also been to the Pakistan earthquake relief. He's had one tour in Bosnia, one tour in Iraq, and one tour in Afghanistan. And on top of all that, he's been an Army IG, so he's pretty much done it all. His family is still up in the Fort Hood area, and he has three sons, Kyle, Ross, and Bryce, of which one of them is a sophomore in the Fighting Texas Aggie Band. Had to get that in. Lieutenant Colonel Phil Brooks is from Fayetteville, Tennessee, and he graduated with a Bachelor of Science degree from the University of Memphis, and he's got a Master's of Arts in Science from the Command and General Staff College. Phil is an artilleryman, and we're lucky this year because aviation and artillery, in my personal opinion, of the combat arms world and combat support world, are the smartest guys we've got. So we're pretty lucky to have these. Phil's done just about everything also. The good thing about Phil is he's actually already on the command list and will take command of a brigade in the... Which division?
3rd Infantry Division.
Yeah, 3rd Infantry Division. Yeah, he's got the rapid go-everywhere brigade starting next year. You'll probably hear a lot more about Phil in the future. Another officer has gone everywhere operationally there is to go as an artilleryman. He's had one tour in Bosnia, three tours in Iraq, and two tours in Afghanistan. So he's been around. His wife Carolyn is also from Fayetteville. She's up in the Fort Hood area also, since both of our guys came from the 1st Cav Division. And they have a 16-year-old son and a 13-year-old daughter. Now, we also have something a little special this year. In past years, when we've had National Guard officers, we've had active duty National Guard officers. So they're active duty all the time, although they're in the reserve, so they're active guard. We have, for the first time, a real live, honest to goodness, National Guardsman who does something else for a living and is in the National Guard on weekends and summers and when we need them to represent the United States. A true citizen soldier is Lieutenant Colonel Brian Farr. Spelled P-F-A-R-R, because we've made that mistake just about every way we can this year with his name. He has a Bachelor of Science and in Business and a Master's in Experimental Education while attending Mankato, State University up in Minnesota. Yes, he really does say Minnesota. Another field artillery officer, and as I told you, he's deployed a couple of times. He's deployed once to Europe to backfill the units in Europe that make deployments, and he's also made a trip to Iraq and back. His family has stayed up in Minnesota in Les Sures. His full-time job in life is the senior vice president of the First Farmers and Merchants Bank in Les Sures. He's also been a past school board member, and he's done all kinds of stuff. And he has a daughter, Catherine, and a son, Henry. Look, their bios are online on the Scowcroft site. Go look at them because they're quite interesting. I've given you only the highlights. I could sit here for the next 45 minutes reading you all the awards these guys have got because they've got one of everything almost, and they're that good, and they're that smart, and we are lucky to have them today. And with that, I think, Blake, you're going first, and I'll turn it over to you.
I'll kick it off. Well, first of all, thanks to Don for the very generous introduction, and probably unnecessary. As we talked about this brief for a while, and Phil and Brian and I, our job in the military, this is probably the hardest brief to ever give, because we don't spend much time, if ever, talking about ourselves. So this is pretty challenging for us to step up here and tell you about ourselves. And Don hit a few high points. What we thought we'd do today in this brief, give you a little background on the fellowship itself, you know, how we got here, and a little bit of a one over the world, if you will, on where the other fellows are and the whole program, and then discuss briefly a little bit about ourselves, our background, you know, the family stuff, and the classes we're taking, and then what we expect to gain out of the class. I'm going to jump into the slides here momentarily, but we tried to highlight in here different things about our careers that you might find interesting. You know, hey, you've worked at this kind of a place or that kind of a place, or you've engaged in this kind of a mission. Something that might be relevant to your experience either here at the Bush School now or in your future down the road. So if you'll bear with us, we're the last thing between you guys and some really good pizza, I understand. So I'll do my best to keep it moving along and try not to stand in front of the screen here. So if I am, just please somebody shout at me. So that's us. That's some really great mug shots there. Awesome. Not very photogenic group, but nonetheless, here we are. So, nothing really to say there. The agenda for the brief, as I said, we're going to talk about the fellowship program itself. Real quick introduction for each of us, and then our experiences, basically the stuff that Don was talking about as far as operations and jobs and missions we've been on. And then the classes we're taking, contributions and expectations, that's what we expect to get out of being here for the year, and what we would like to receive in return from the student body and the faculty here at the Bush School. Partnership and engagement as well, we've got some underlying missions while we're here. It's not a free chicken for us or a free ride. We actually have to come here and do the ambassador for the Army thing as well, which we're fortunate. We're very lucky to even be here to do it, so we embrace that job as well. And then lastly, and we really like to engage you guys with some questions. Whatever's on your mind, I mean, any topic, I'm going to bring everybody up front, and then we'll do our level best to answer them to the best of our ability. So with that said, the overview. The officer education program, there's a lot of facets to it. The first thing first is skills training. Each one of us, as Don stated, you know, I'm an Army aviator, got two field artillerymen here, so they fire the cannons and the artillery. You know, we all know about the infantry. Everybody starts off in the Army with some type of branch, and you go into a branch, and whatever that may be, chemical, ordnance, finance. So we all start off with the basic skill training at your officer basic, and that's part of your military education. In order to be an officer in the military, you start off, you have to have a bachelor's degree, and then I'm going to talk here in a minute. As we get up further in the ranks where we are now, you end up with your master's degree. The military education level courses, and use this little red pointer if y'all can see that. Military education level starts off with your officer basic when you first come out of college with your degree, in most cases, and then throughout your career you come back for continuing education opportunities. About the 8 to 10 year mark in your career, when you're a major, you go to Fort Leavenworth, Kansas for what they call Command and General Staff College. And that is basically a master's level granting class, about 800 resident students at the time. They break you down into small groups much like you do here, 16 people per team. And they do a little, what I call the NFL draft, basically make sure you've got one infantry, one armor, one Air Force soldier, you know, and a good mix in the team so you get a good discussion, because that's really where most of the learning happens in the informal settings. Throughout your career, as I said, that's about the 8 to 10 year mark. Now coming back, we are in the Army War College. The other term for that is the Senior Service College. Senior Service College is based out of Carlisle, Pennsylvania. And we went up there for a 2 week in processing, and I'll call it an indoctrination. They want to get us up to speed with the latest issues in the Army, make sure that we're going to do the right thing down here, understand what the rules are, and tell us what our job is while we're here. So we're now in the War College. That's probably how I'll continue to refer for the remainder of the brief. And as a War College, like I said, there's a resident course. Let's see if I can light this thing up. So the resident course, and then there's the Army Fellows. And I'm going to get into the big picture here because I think it'll help you understand. The resident course has 387 students that are up in Carlisle, Pennsylvania right now. Of those, there's also 29 DOD civilians that are in the same classes with them, which is great, and it's a good thing that the Army offers those opportunities for the civilian force as well. And of those 387, included in that are the international students. So students from Iran, Pakistan, you name it. We've got all different kinds of flavors, and then every service is also represented there. So you've got Air Force officers. There was one Coast Guard officer up there, a small service, but nonetheless they represented Marines and all the services, like I said. So of those guys, this is now us down here. We're part of the 92. That's a great number for me, class 92. And across, I counted 49 locations, so I'm one of those maybe right
around. I'll defer to you.
But nonetheless. So this is a kind of a, as I promised, the map picture. So quick orientation, that's the United States. Here's us down here in Texas. And then you can see, so in the academic year of 15, there's 92 Army War College Fellows. It is a very competitive. We have to turn in our requests. I think each one of us, you probably had to be A&M number one to even get in the running. And then we were fortunate enough to get picked. But as you can see, there's some pretty high-powered names on there, as well as the Bush School, Yale, Harvard, and then some interesting places, which I'm sure you guys discuss and know, Brookings, DOL, DOJ, and those kind of locations as well. So there's a lot of different opportunities out there, depending on your background, whether you're a special forces officer, or you're in intel, or whatever the case may be. You know, they've got something for you, bottom line, depending on what your interest levels are. And then lastly, there are some that are outside of the continental United States. I don't know the number there, but these are the places. So it's Hawaii, Rome. A lot of those have language requirements, so you can't even get past the screening criteria if you don't speak French or whatever the case may be. Which is why we're here, because I speak English. Sometimes. Most of the time. And then last, here at the top, that acronym is, there's 12 Chief of Staff of the Army Senior Fellows. So these are officers who are, you know, Phil and I just got promoted to colonel here most recently. Brian's promoted to colonel. But these are officers who've already attended the War College. They are senior colonels now, and they are coming back at the behest of the Chief of Staff of the Army to go do some very high-level strategic projects on behalf of the Chief. And those ones are the ones that are highlighted in blue. Any questions on that chart? Okay. Moving right along then. All right, real quick, as I said, this will be brief, be brilliant, and be gone. That's me. I'm Colonel Blake Alexander. I did get my education here at Texas A&M. IRNA, and my bachelor's is in political science and German. I did the double major while I was here. I was also in the Corps of Cadets, which caused me to be around for the fifth year, like a lot of people do. So that's the fact of life here. Got my master's when I was at Fort Leavenworth at night school. So while you're going through your day coursework, there's an opportunity there to do night coursework for a year. So I accomplished my master's there. Military overview, I was commissioned in 92 from A&M as an ROTC officer. I'm an Army aviator for Blackhawks as my aircraft. This is my number one choice. It's a good trend going here. Things are working out for me. And done it for 22 years. So I've been on active duty for 22 years. So in all of our cases, we were in well before 9/11 and well after. Deployments to Bosnia, because that was the going thing back then in the mid to late 90s. And then Iraq and Afghanistan. I'm the surge officer, so I was in the surge in Iraq and the surge in Afghanistan. Timing works out. Married, my wife is Maggie. I met her here. Best decision I ever made. And we've been married the whole time, and she's actually much smarter than I. She's a biomedical science major from here, of which she's never used that skill because she married this guy and went around the world. Just some asides here. I'm a scout master. I'm an Eagle Scout. My kids are all Eagle Scouts, and I got about 13 Eagle Scout uncles. It's kind of a big deal in our family. And they kind of look at you like, what's wrong with you if you're not? So no pressure, right? This is one of my high school buddies there, Wayne Brewster. He and I went to Robert G. Cole High School down in Fort Sam Houston. He went to West Point, I went to A&M. We finally met on the battlefield in Afghanistan in 2012, which is great to see that guy. That's my son, Kyle. He's in the band, my wife. And then bookends there, the twins. They're high school seniors at Copper's Cove. And then my last job, as Don said, was in the horse attachment. Good Lord. I was with the IG, but we went out to the horse attachment to go have some fun one day. So that was worth it. Real quick, my experience, I already kind of hit on the UH-60 thing there. That's my aircraft. I've done all the jobs from as a lieutenant, as a platoon leader, all the way up. I've worked as a Corps aviation officer. Just That's normal for us at our time in service to have gone most of those levels of leadership. We've worked in Alabama, Virginia, Texas, Kansas, and my first assignment was in Germany, which was pretty convenient coming out of here with a German degree at the time. That worked out well. And one interesting thing about myself, I was a teacher. I taught and commanded the Aviation Captain's Career Course, so standing on the platform is not new to me. And staying ahead of students, I'm tracking. The work that goes behind the scenes to make sure you're ready for the next class. Did that for 2 years. I also worked at the Human Resources Command for the Army, and I ended up working for the big boss up there, the general. Started off as an aviation assignments guy, so you're telling other guys where you're going to move to, whether it's, you know, okay, you're at Fort Hood long enough, you need to go elsewhere for their careers. As Don said, I did do Hurricane Katrina and Rita. It was crazy. And I'd love to talk to you guys if you have questions about that down the road. I did Bosnia way back, and then Iraq during the surge, as I said, and Afghan during the surge. I was Aviation Battalion Task Force Commander over there, so I had medevac, I had Apaches, I had Chinooks and Blackhawks, about 43 aircraft, and I was in a great little place called Shinban, if you need to go Google that sometime. It's about 30 miles from the Iranian border, so it was high adventure. And I'm not going to jump more on that. Real quick, classes-wise, I'm a poli-sci background, so I was leaning more towards the SA side of the house. So I chose Foundations of Public Service to start off with, Comparative Public Admin, and something that I know nothing about, Strategic Finance for Nonprofits. So I thought I'd just broaden myself and take something that I had no idea, which is living up to the legend. And then I'm trying to go after the Dean Certificate for Leadership while I'm here, and I got the Management Leadership, so I thought, hey, at least I'll have something cool to talk about when I get down the road. And then what I haven't said, and I'll take the thunder here, we're all assigned, we have to do a short paper in the fall and a long paper, which is called a civilian research project, in the springtime. Short paper's due for us here in November, and then I think the big one, which is basically master's thesis-like, in March, April time frame. So our topics, where everybody's going to say what theirs is. Right now I'm leaning towards the Army ethic, leadership type stuff, and then subordinate leader development, which maybe lead me down the road into counseling. So just FYI, in case you're interested in that kind of stuff, or you have something you know about that, I welcome your input. So with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Phil, let him have the control, and thanks for your time and attention.
Thanks. And as Blake said, probably the hardest thing for us to do is talk about ourselves. We enjoy talking about a lot of other topics, but when it comes to talking about ourselves, that's the tough part, but I'll give it a shot here. I have Phil Brooks, and I see a couple of my partner students in here, so it's great to see you here as well. I'm not an Aggie, but I'm learning the lingo very quick. So gig them. I did go to the University of Memphis, formerly known as Memphis State, and I got a Master's in Military Arts and Science from the Command and General Staff College there, as Don said in our introduction. I was commissioned through the ROTC program at Memphis State, and we do shoot the big guns in the field of artillery. I'll talk a little more about my deployments in the next slide, but I have seen a lot of the Middle East and European countries in my short 20-plus years in the military. And thankfully, because I have a supportive spouse and kids that you can see up there, so I had to have a photo that was different from all the camouflage. So that's my motley crew right there. Recently returned from a beach in Florida. And just to continue on with that photo, this photo in the bottom right there is from Mosul, Iraq. You've probably heard a lot about that in the news lately with the ISIS coverage. I commanded a task force there, and I was partnered with the Iraqi special police, as well as some of the sheikhs there, for to keep the peace there in Mosul, out west to Tal Afar, and down south. Pretty big area of responsibility. These were my BFFs, and frankly did a great job while I was there. I'm not sure it's that way right now, according to the news. Just moving over, this is, as Blake mentioned, the CSA Chief Staff of the Army. That's General Odierno in my operations center, providing a brief there, 2009, on the security situation there. that point, we were beginning to hand over a lot of the operating bases and the outposts within the city of Mosul, because historically, we watched Al-Qaeda move from in and around Baghdad, north towards Mosul, and then back towards Syria. So this was during that time as Al-Qaeda was moving back. We were still fighting, but we could see some movement back towards the Syrian border. And then this last photo up in the upper left is from February of this year, eastern Afghanistan. Those are my little buddies, and they helped help me do what I did in counterinsurgency operations, really. There is a task force commander. I had Czech Republic soldiers. I had an Air Force Security Forces squadron, a Jordanian battalion, of course, my battalion, and we were partnered with the Afghan National Police and National Army. And so that's really just an insight on the human domain where we touched as part of counterinsurgency operations there in eastern Afghanistan. So that's me. Like Blake, I have been at the platoon leader level. You've seen the war movies through the division level. I started out overseas. I first had orders to go to Hawaii, but I was getting married, and I thought Hawaii is probably the wrong place for me to go as a newlywed. So I was able to swap assignments with somebody to go to Germany, and then 6 months later, I ended up in Bosnia. So I didn't get the newlywed experience there for a while. It was a little delayed. And then several stateside assignments. One that was very beneficial to me was at Fort Irwin, California, at our Army's National Training Center. That is where we simulate combat in the desert. And I had the opportunity to train multiple aviation and artillery units on how to synchronize some of the lethal fires that we employ in this decisive action. And it's a combination of the Federal Aviation Administration and controlling airspace and separating the big bullets in time so that you don't see helicopters and jets get shot down. So very beneficial to me, and enjoyed that time out there with my family. Actually, it was predictable. It was in the desert, but it was a predictable schedule, so my wife got annual tickets to Disneyland and every 4 days we were there. Like Blake, several deployments there as a lieutenant back in my first 2 years. I was part of the implementation force for the Dayton Peace Accord when we were separating Serbs and Croats. I lived in the zone of separation with my platoon to make sure the two forces there didn't go against each other. And it was a great experience there at the lower levels. My first tour in Iraq, I was the executive officer for a two-star general, responsible for training the Iraqi police under a couple of folks named Petraeus, Dempsey, and the likes. Very educational, and we worked with Department of State on a daily basis, and I believe it was that Ambassador Khalilzad was there, and then Ambassador Crocker came in. Ambassador Napper might have been there during that time.
2008, yeah.
Okay, and we worked with we were partnered with the Ministry of Interior as well. And in the initial 6 months, it was a Sunni representative, and then the Minister of Finance came to be the Minister of Interior, overseeing all the police forces there inside of Iraq. So Department of State, Department of Justice, INL, several NGOs, just a great experience for me, and actually enabled me to write my thesis the following year when I came up for air and got my master's at Fort Leavenworth. Went right back after a year of schooling after I got my master's, again as an executive to a two-star in Baghdad, over the multinational division Baghdad during the surge, much like Blake. So there were 9 brigade combat teams and a whole lot of American uniformed folks in and around Baghdad, so responsible for the security of Baghdad. And as Al-Qaeda moved up, I got a reprieve from that job and became the operations officer in Balad, Samarra, in that area as I watched Al-Qaeda. So got to chase them and start working the counterinsurgency mission up north of Baghdad there. Came back for a year, became a brigade executive officer, which is kind of chief of staff, if you will, over the brigade combat team. Reset, and then deployed again, this time to Mosul. And after about a month and a half, one of the battalion commanders was killed by a suicide bomber. I was on the list to become a battalion commander back in the States, but my boss said, you know me, you know how I fight, and I want you to become my battalion commander. So I assumed command of that task force in Mosul and fought the counterinsurgency fight up there with them for the remainder of the year. And great experience, tough. I wouldn't wish it on anybody here, having to pick up where a battalion commander left off there. And then came back, and I thought I was moving on to come up for air again. And I took another battalion at Fort Bliss in El Paso, Texas, an artillery battalion, fresh start. And 6 months later, a guy named Allen, who is now the vice chief staff in the Army, was the division commander for Hood, said, Brooks, I need you to go with me. I'm going to Afghanistan, and I need a deputy chief of staff. So I had the opportunity there in eastern Afghanistan to watch the tough fighting there against multiple non-traditional actors, as Professor McNamee would be proud to hear right now. So a tough fight there. Came back, trained up another unit, and then deployed them to Afghanistan last July and returned in March. So high operational tempo there, but it's been fun. It's been a great ride. The military education, you've seen the Command General Staff College, the Joint Forces Staff College. The only thing I'll highlight is, and I see some Advanced Civil Schooling Service members in here, but the higher up you go, or the longer you're in the military, the more the service chiefs encourage you to be joint qualified. In other words, you have to serve with the other services, because at the enterprise, the Department of Defense, you see multiple uniforms, and those of you that have done the internships know that you see all services there, and so we all have to communicate the same language. So I went to that language school in Norfolk this spring, as soon as I got back from Afghanistan, frankly, for 10 weeks, and that was a great experience working with the Navy and Marine Corps and the Air Force senior officers there. So needless to say, I'm in the IA department based on that background. It's great to see you again, some of my classmates here. I'm taking Professor McNamee's classes on terrorism and technical collections. As Don said, I will go and take command of about 5,000 soldiers next summer, close to Savannah, Georgia, Fort Stewart. They are what the Army is now referring to as a regionally aligned force to European command. So I'm going to focus my time on doing some research here on my next job. And I know I've been in a couple of classes, and some of the interns from UConn, I will be picking on them for some information as well, but I look forward to that. And with that, I'll turn it over to Brian.
Thanks, Bill.
Howdy. Howdy. Howdy.
So I'm trying to remove the Scandinavian dialect from that. If I slip, you betcha in there, forgive me. So like Don said, quite a bit different experience from these two. We'll walk you through that here. First off, education. So a bachelor's of science in business administration at Minnesota State, Mankato, southwestern Minnesota. And a master's of experiential education there as well. Military overview, enlisted in the National Guard in 87, right out of high school, and became a candidate crewman, and then commissioned through the ROTC program at Mankato State, and became a field artillery officer. So Don mentioned a traditional National Guard soldier, so when I'm not wearing the uniform, I'll show you next slide what a picture of me looks like. If I were a little better at photoshopping, I would have done those where half of it was a civilian, but I couldn't do it. So 27 years of total experience, and then we'll talk about a couple of deployments. it's here coming up. So this is more of what I usually look like when I go to work. But on the personal side, married 23 years to my wife, Kristen. She is a high school guidance counselor in southern Minnesota. My daughter, Catherine, or Katie, is a sophomore at the University of Minnesota Duluth, studying to be an elementary education, or in that field. And then my son, Henry, or Hank, is a senior in high school, so they are back in Minnesota. Now, however, a couple months ago, my son and I did have a discussion about if you don't learn to get along with your mother a little bit better, I will enroll you in a school down in Texas and you'll live here with me. And quickly he adjusted his attitude. So the civilian career, then, when I'm not wearing the uniform, I am currently a senior vice president at First Farmers and Merchants, a small family-owned bank. We call it small in southern Minnesota. They have 18 locations. It's about a $670 million bank total assets. The branch that I work at is about $275 million in total assets. And the branch that I work at in Le Sueur, I manage the loan department and primarily working in ag and commercial loan department, so foreign lending. So experience there again, 23 years commissioned, 4 years enlisted. Like these guys, experience through the tactical and operational level from platoon through division. Same sort of experiences there, all in the National Guard in Minnesota. Some overseas training opportunities, whereas primarily our training has been in northern Minnesota, Camp Ripley, maybe Fort McCoy in Wisconsin. I have had the opportunity to train in Korea with Team Spirit in 1990, Norway several times as a part of the NATO Composite Force, the UK, and then Germany most recently in an Austrian challenge environment. So have had the opportunity to do some overseas training with the Guard. Called to state active duty 3 times in my career, so you know, an important part of our mission is to have DOM ops and be able to help local civilian authorities. The first one in 97 up in the Red River Valley, northern Minnesota, worked with FEMA there, and primarily as a logistician. We downloaded supplies at an airport and got them to where they wanted to be, where they were needed. So worked with FEMA a lot in that one. The second flood in 2005 in southeastern Minnesota, a lot more varying terrain down there. They had 19 inches of rain in just over 24 hours. So that took a task force of about 150 soldiers down there, worked with the county government there on just road guards, went out to some remote parts of the county to do some health and welfare checks. And then once the tornado, when I commanded the service battery there in St. Peter, Minnesota, back in 1998, the state had a tornado on the ground for about 60 miles, upwards of a mile wide at times. It went through the largest community, which was St. Peter, about 10,000 people. So I spent 2 weeks there working with several different agencies during that time frame. Had the opportunity to command a couple different batteries, field artillerymen, the 109A5, just the predecessor to the Paladin. And then when I went to the division, working in operations, and deployed as the chief of ops for the 34th ID in Iraq and in multinational division south, as you can see there. Just came off of battalion command this summer. And so two deployments there. The first one in 03, where I worked S2, S3, so Intel and Ops in Europe. We were working for United States Air Forces of Europe, and primarily because most of those active duty soldiers were in the desert. We were security forces, military police, that sort of thing. And then the second one, again, chief of operations in the MMDS in Fatherland. So fall courses, I have, like Blake, the Foundations of Public Service with Professor Bullock, and then microeconomics analysis for public policy with Dr. Griffin. Research topics I haven't fully narrowed down, but I'm looking at a couple different areas here based off of experience. So under the National Guard side and some experience there, you know, looking at should we be continue to be an operational force or maybe just a strategic reserve like we were 10 years ago or a decade ago, or should Homeland Defense be the sole mission of the National Guard? And then from the banking side of the house and economics, you know, one area that interests me is just the cost effectiveness of the reserve component versus the active component. And then another one is the sustainability of current personnel costs across the military and how that looks going forward. So a couple different areas there, still narrowing that down. So with that, I think I'll turn it back over.
I was just told to be brief here, so I will. Because I want you to have the opportunity to ask questions. And you know our background, what we kind of bring to the classroom. If any of you have classes with us, if any of you see us out, feel free to stop us. But we met with General Retired Ramirez, Commandant of the Corps of Cadets, recently, and he said, "Hey, Brooks, you guys bring current." He said, "I'm an old man. You guys are fresh off the streets. And that's where we need you." And I served with General Ramirez in a previous life, so he's a great American. He said, "I need you to get out there and help me." So we're here for you, bottom line. We do have experience, as you heard, with state, justice, INL, NGOs, IOs. So feel free to pick our brain. We do bring a military viewpoint to the IANSA departments there. We're on your team. I know grad classes are hard, we've all been there, so hang with us. But we're also here to gain and broaden our own perspective on policy. We're the executors of policy. And someday in the near future, a lot of grad students in here are going to be working right beside us. And so we want to help you help us. And so that's why we're here. So we look forward to working with each and every one of you. The disclaimer right in front of us, we have our own alphabet. And you got three old stinkers right here with over 20 years in the military. Okay, so we have our own language. Call us on it. Ask for further explanation because we owe it to you to get the message out. As I mentioned, grad students, you're going to be working closely with us or our bosses probably somewhere. I work closely with a lot of young State Department personnel in Iraq. Fresh out of college, so it was great. It's humbling to call them sir, ma'am, but it was great. But again, we intend to learn from you, so challenge us, and I look forward to the dialogue throughout the year. So, and something about us, I'm not going to insult anybody's intelligence. It's, as Blake mentioned, it's a selection process for us to get here. It's very unique. And we look forward to taking advantage of that opportunity. Take advantage of us as well. We are here for you, and we look forward to learning from all of you. So with that, I'm going to get my cohorts up here.
Yeah.
Feel free to fire.
I think that's our last slide, the last one set of questions. So, and I hope you guys got something out of that. I hope it was beneficial for you. Give you a little insight to where how we got here and what we have in our, we like to say, in our rucksack. The experiences you're a victim of your own circumstances sometimes. So we've got our own things that we've carried with us throughout the courses of our careers, the different experiences that come along with that. So with that said, thanks for your time and attention, and then I'll open it up to any questions for any of us, or if we can't get it, we'll get back to you and get you the right answer. Any other questions? Pepperoni.
Experience doing the technical collections, dealing with a lot of other three-letter agencies, and he saw in different countries. So, frankly, what's new to me is the historical aspect. For me, I was building the puzzle as I went. But as we began to build, Gentleman Crystal, frankly, started building the fusion cells through Special Operations Command. I was a beneficiary of that in 2006 in Baghdad because we worked closely with Special Operations Command. So the historic nature of it, frankly, is what has been beneficial to me so far. And I know it's early, and I know Professor McNamee has a lot of experience. I see a couple of my classmates here. But that's what I'm getting from it right now. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so my name is Morten. I'm from Denmark originally, so this pertains to your experience via the abroad. All three of you have either been on, exercises or have been stationed abroad.
Yeah.
It appears to me that military education here is very institutionalized in one way or the other, and it's not what I recognize from my experiences abroad, so I was wondering if you had any reflections on how the way American education happens in the American military is dissimilar to systems abroad.
I don't have a great scope of comparison because I've never gone through any other education system, I guess. But it is very institutionalized. I mean, we have an entire command in the Army that's dedicated to training and doctrine. And that's where all the schoolhouses in the Army reside under one general officer's command. And the program of instruction there are pretty regimented. They're, of course, we're all bound by time because there's a limited amount of time for an officer or enlisted soldier, for that matter, to attend a school before they need you back in an operational unit. So there's a finite number of hours in the day that they can get this knowledge into you, what you need to know. And then based on what we see right now, I mean, one of our biggest trainers, if you will, is the operational experiences. So people are picking up, you can get, I would offer in my lane, an aviation officer going out, you get about 5 years worth of experience in one deployment to Afghanistan because it is so rapid over there. So a lot of our learning is institutionalized and it is kind of regimented, I suppose. And it comes at these predictable times in our career, for the Army anyway. It may not be that way for all services. But the other side of the coin is for the operational deployments are equally educational.
I was just going to say, the only thing I would offer there is the United States Army also does a lot of security cooperation exercises in Europe, and we are a partner with folks from your country as well. So for us, it's a great opportunity to become educated through those security cooperation exercises as well. The unit that I'm taking command of next summer is currently in Germany right now. Doing a security cooperation exercise with several countries, frankly, and I have learned more, as much, and maybe more from my counterparts as I have through our regimented system as well. So it's a great opportunity for us to learn from the other countries as well.
Leavenworth, they let you take some half the year. You do what they call the core coursework, and then you have the opportunity to take electives. And I would tell you that this level here, we've had free flow to sit in, take as many and all, whatever kind of classes we want. So it's the first chance to really direct your own studies.
You saw, earlier, so there's 300 and some odd in the institutionalized Army training, but there's 92 of us out here, so I think the military is trying to do a better job of gaining some perspectives. And there's, you know, I see a couple other folks sitting here that are not going through the formal military institution, but coming out here to get a master's degree like Steve here, so there is another process, and that's why the 92 of us are out here trying to get gain some insight from other areas rather than just the institution.
Haven't written on this before. Let me just throw this out. The biggest difference between the U.S. Army and all the other armies in the world is we actually have a personnel account that allows us to take folks out of units and let them go to school without hurting operational units. Most other countries in the world, the guy has to leave his operational unit to go to school and then he goes back to his unit. We're one of the few countries that has an operational account for students that doesn't perk units.
Thank God. Yeah. Do you guys ever plan on taking the education you're getting now and perhaps retiring at some point and moving to the private sector?
I'll say yes to that. I always thought I'd be a city manager when I was walking the streets here at A&M, and I haven't quite given up on that dream yet, but if not, I find myself, I think, maybe in some kind of talent management or consulting type role down the road. So I think being here at Bush School is perfect for an opportunity to get those kind of knowledge that I missed along the way.
Okay.
How about you guys?
Likewise. I mean, based on my experience, I will focus more on the management side because I have never been a recruiter and I couldn't sell anything. But actually, waste management kind of interests me, and I think there are a lot of opportunities in the waste management field. But yes, I will retire, and yes, it will be long.
Yeah, no, and so for me, those experiences, I've been able to correlate those over a civilian career and military back and forth, you know, for the last 27 years. And obviously, I feel that the question many times, you know, what's your civilian employer doing for the year? And yeah, it's a hardship for them, but I hope, I like to think that the things that I bring, because of the things that I learned here, back to them, at least partially pays them for letting me go to do these things. So, I mean, I've been doing that for the last 27 years, taking things that I've learned in this career and applying them there and vice versa. So.
Go ahead.
What benefits do you see to sort of being able to, for a short period of time, step out of the normal Army culture and be able to sort of examine it and have experiences outside of it, sort of get a break from being on active duty, and how you feel that that will help you and possibly change or alter your management style or how you deal with the civilian contractors in your job?
I'll give it a shot.
I've
had a couple of breaks. As you saw from the slide, I've been in command of three different battalions for the last almost 4 years, which means I've had a BlackBerry on my hip 24/7, or I've been in combat 24/7 for the last 4 years, answering phone calls about some young soldier getting in trouble or whatever. This is my year of reading, writing, and reflection. And, you know, there are physical things that drop, even though we're all physically fit, you know, those bones aren't as young as they were. There are family things that we juggle, and I'm sure a lot of the business executives do the same. But I call it juggling glass balls, and those are things that we can't drop. So whether it's physical fitness, spiritual fitness, family, those are the glass balls. And so this is an opportunity to realign those and get those back in the right juggling formation, if you will, and really a time for me to come up for air and look back and say, okay, I did this. If I had the opportunity to lead soldiers again, is that the way I would do it now? And so it gives me a chance to kind of step back and say, okay, are we still on course? So at least for Brooks, that's the way I would do it.
The only thing I would add to that, and I echo everything Phil said, I've been further removed from Afghanistan, so I kind of had my decompression time while I was doing the NIG, if you want to call it that. We can talk Inspector General stuff some other time. But the only thing I will add is, in addition to the opportunity, and really that's how we look at it, is it really shows the Army's commitment to us. The Chief of Staff of the Army, one of the big watchwords right now is broadening officers. And just stopping the training long enough, they're paying our salary to be here to make us a full-time student, that sends the right message to the force. We're telling the young guys that we care about them, we care about their balance, and we care about their education. And the opportunity to do it here, you know, we do get the chance to take a step back and look at our leadership, our management skills, and maybe hone them in a different direction, because you can easily fall into the Army way all the time. You know, and that's not always perfect. One more question.
Okay. Matt. I noticed y'all have you all been married for over 20 years, which is impressive, especially in the military. Have you guys
deer.
Wow, okay. We could probably each jump on that grenade. That's probably about right. I'll tell you, I mean, we all probably will tell you that we married up, you know, and above our love. And I think that's, my wife runs our house. She is awesome. And not everybody can always say that. I guess, you know, it's finding the right person. But in our case, I think, you know, with deployments and things of that nature, I mean, you can't say enough about Army spouses. Because when we're gone, guess who's got to do all the flat tires, the insurance, the bills, deal with the kids, and all that good stuff. We're lucky. And we all know what's in the papers. I mean, there's a lot of divorce in the military with the numerous away from home time that soldiers are enduring right now with the last 10, 11 years of war. So are we the norm? I'd say we're probably in the minority, but I don't think it's a big minority. I mean, what am I trying to say there? It's not like 10%, maybe 40%. You know? I don't know. There's no magic solution to that one, I guess. Yes, deer probably works. Anyway, I hope that's a good enough answer for you. I couldn't tell you. Do what your boss tells you to do. It works well.
No, I think we'll get to that. It's a tough life, you know, and I have vowed not to let my son go into the military because I know I would worry myself sick about it, but that's not, you know, it's his decision. I'm the only military from my family. I don't know what their background is, but the Army is a family, and the higher up you get, the more and more names that you see that serve with you or under.
Warm bush right here.